Now, as soon as the Shafir trial ended, the denials started, didn't they? Honour killings have nothing to do with Islam. They're an issue of domestic violence. And then we had a rather odd and sometimes extreme Muslim leader announcing a fatwa on them. What utter nonsense. We had Robert Spencer here talking about this, but we need to address this again because this particular imam, we need to ask this man, OK, you say you condemn honour killings. Well, how would you react if, say, your daughter married a Christian, or your son said he was gay, or one of them wanted to convert? How would you act? You might not, I'm sure you wouldn't indulge in an honour killing, but what would you say? Would you be open and understanding? I wonder. Pam Geller joins us from New York. Welcome to you.
Thank you so much for having me, Michael.
Now, you know, I could have predicted this one. We knew it would happen. As soon as the verdict came down, the first thing that people were saying, even police officers involved in the trial and the investigation, domestic violence, nothing to do with religion. It may be cultural. Well, 91% of all honor killings involve Islam and Muslims.
Yes. Listen, this is part of the obfuscation and the denial that we see immediately, the knee-jerk, even in the case of Jessica Mokdad. As you know, you'll be speaking at our conference, the Jessica Mokdad Human Rights Conference on Honor Killings. Upon her execution by her stepfather, the mother, the prosecutor, the district attorney all said it was an honor killing. And here we are, a year later, we are being vilified for using her name because it wasn't an honor killing. This is part of the cover-up. Look, if the Muslim community was really honest about this, they'd be holding classes, and they would be teaching why they shouldn't be killing their children. We know. Here is Reliance of the Traveler, the sacred book on Islamic law, page 584. There is no penalty for honor killings, and we see in Muslim countries there's a lenient sentence for honor killings. We know that over 90% of the honor killings in the world are Islamic in nature. This is denial of reality. You can, you know, avoid reality, but you cannot avoid the consequences of avoiding reality, and the consequences of avoiding this particular reality is the rise of Islamic honor killings in the West, in Canada, in Europe. And we have to stand up because it's anti-human not to stand up.
Yes.
It is egregious and monstrous for us not to look. In the case of a Florida honor killing, Fatima Abdullah, who was honor killed, her killing was classified as a suicide. And my informant in the medical examiner's office told me that they were afraid of Muslim reprisals if it was classified as an honor killing. Is that where we are as a society, where we're afraid of offending Islam so much so that we will allow you to murder your children so as not to offend Islam?
Well, it has to be emphasized.
Monstrous.
Well, it is. And, you know, those of us who step forward and say this is wrong. Look, I'm not going to be a victim. I'm a grown man. I'm not a Muslim. The victims are Muslim women. So those people who say, well, this is racist or this ludicrous term Islamophobic, it's about defending young, generally young Muslim women. But let me put this to you. I wrote a piece in The Spectator, the British magazine, and you know, lots of comments, but a few of them said, well, if you look at the Old Testament, there are references to effectively honor killings. The point, though, is that in the history of Judaism and the history of Christianity, this has never been a theme or an issue. There's never been this obsession with honor killings. It's always been, no, it's an absolute crime and sin to do so. Why this, you mentioned obfuscation, why this double talk, obfuscation, denial? Why are people so frightened? I don't think they're physically frightened. They seem morally frightened of drawing an absolute and saying who is doing the killing.
Well, they're clueless as opposed to complicit. This biblical reference, no Jewish parents are killing their children, no Christian parents are killing their children, it's not happening. And look, you can't equate it. There was an enlightenment, there was a reform, there was a Vatican II. You know, in Judaism and in Christianity, what we need, of course, is a reformation in Islam. And it's not you and I who can bring that about. It has to come from within the Muslim world. But certainly the West should be ostracizing and making pariahs of those that adhere to devout or authentic or pure Islam. When we're, in effect, what we're doing is we're sanctioning a pure Islam. We're sanctioning authentic Islam and making it more difficult for the true radicals, the true reformers. The true radicals are in Islam are those that speak out against this, the Wafa Sultans, the Ibn Wariqs. These are the people that you don't see on television and should. But who do you see on television? You see Muslim Brotherhood proxies. You see Muslim Brotherhood operatives like the Council of American Islamic Relations. Who decided that they speak for Muslims in the West? I don't believe that. I don't believe that they speak for Muslims in the West. But clearly, the media, the enemedia, the Sharia-compliant media, the self-enforcing Sharia-compliant media has deemed them the spokesman. And it is outrageous because I must tell you, Michael, I get emails from Muslims every day, either looking for help, either quietly lauding me. They can't come out publicly because they'll be ostracized by their community and so on and so forth. We have to help those people. Those are the people that we should be heralding, not the Muslim Brotherhood or the Islamic supremacist groups. It's outrageous on its face.
And let's talk about freedom and censorship here, because you mentioned a conference earlier, and we're going to promote this and announce this and deal with this conference on the station. A group of people who understand this issue, most of them far more high profile and more informed than me, are assembling. You said to me, Michael, if you agree to speak at this conference, you will be attacked. There'll be enormous pressure on the venue to try and stop it happening. We were chatting before the show. There will be security. There will be armed security to make sure that we are not attacked merely for expressing an opinion. This is extraordinary.
It is extraordinary. The attack on speech is extraordinary. Yes, I did give you an out because I feel that Robert Spencer and I have become the tip of the spear here in America. We're the most effective in terms of fighting jihad on their playing field. You know, when they run these ads, we run counter ads. Of course, we get censored. You know, in New York, for example, they ran anti-Israel ads to stop aid to Israel. So I submitted my ads, my pro-Israel ads, and my ads were rejected.
Yeah.
My ads were rejected. My ad said, in any war between the civilized man, side with the civilized man. Support Israel, defeat jihad. And because I used the word savage, my ads were rejected.
So even
now
in New York.
Yes, I'm suing New York City. I've sued Dearborn. Dearborn would not run my Leaving Islam ads. They were running ads, you know, come to Islam, why Islam, proselytizing for Islam. And I ran ads that said, you know, leaving Islam, is there a fatwa on your head? Is your family threatening you? And they wouldn't run them. Now, I have to tell you, this is where we're having the conference, by the way, on the anniversary of Jessica Mokdad's death. Let me say this. Though, when I won that case, Michael, when I won that case against Dearborn, my ads were supposed to run that week, and they wouldn't put my ads up. That was the week that she was murdered, execution style, by her stepfather. Who's to say if she saw an ad, we could have gotten to a safe house? Who's to say what would have been? How many lives, how many people have to die before? I mean, this is the question. People will always say, well, how many people have actually died?
I wish I had more time, but I have to stop. Look, you're quite right. You know, we've said this before, but white guilt is a terrible thing to waste. And what does it lead to? Pam, as always, a pleasure. We'll have you back on the show. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Michael.